Welcome back to another episode of Doing Football, finishing our top 10 wide receiver rankings. Jared, we need the people to help us out with the views.
Yes.
The views need to explode. We need to get up the charts. People need to check out the videos on YouTube. If you're watching,
like.
Look, take pity on me. Like the video.
Subscribe. Comment.
Subscribe. Do it all. Today, finishing our top 10 wide receivers. So a lot of these guys we're talking about, we have talked about in the previous video. We'll put it down in the description, so go check it out.
Make sure you watch that one first.
Yeah, watch that one first.
Give you a lot of detail for this one.
Yeah, we'll kind of run through things a bit more on this one with most of the guys we talked about. There are a few left over that we can give some details on. But Jared, after an incredible performance in the episode earlier in the week, who do you have at number six?
At number six, I have DeAndre Hopkins of the Cardinals. You had him a bit higher than me. I still love him. I think he's going to be a great receiver. He's going to put up a lot of receptions, a lot of yards. I just don't know if the touchdowns are going to be quite as high as people think or might think they go up by. And, like, this is a pretty crowded offense. And, like, I'm not saying, like, guys like Rondell Moore or A.J. Green are going to take things away from DeAndre Hopkins, but it will impact how much volume he actually gets. And in the red zone, I don't know if they're going to actually target him that often. They got Kyler Murray there. He's going to run the ball in a lot. And I don't know. I could see him having an incredible year yardage and reception-wise, but a little bit less in the touchdowns, which is why I have him outside of my top five.
Yeah, Kenyon Drake was really high in rushing attempts in the red zone. I kind of feel like they might make an adjustment this season and change that because it was Kenyon Drake, it was Kyler Murray, even Chase Edmonds. There wasn't enough to go around for DeAndre Hopkins. I felt there should be more volume for him. He had 20 red zone targets, only three touchdowns. There were 23 players that had 20 or more red zone targets last season, and he had the least amount of touchdowns. He was the bottom at three touchdowns. So I think he's due for some positive regression there, and I think they should make some adjustments. I like DeAndre Hopkins a little bit more. He almost had as many targets as Stephon Diggs did last season. So great floor there. And the touchdowns are the missing piece. And if that comes together, I think he could have a huge season for you. So at number six for me, another person we talked about in our previous video, again, down in the description, go check it out if you haven't already. Keenan Allen of the Los Angeles Chargers. Love Keenan Allen this season. Love my Chargers. Kind of not a fan of everybody hyping up Austin Eckler and Keenan Allen this season, Justin Herbert, the whole team, to have a big year. I just need people to be quiet. Stay quiet about my team. Because it seems like way too often people are like, the Chargers could be that sneaky team this year. Yeah. So I hate seeing that. But Keenan Allen, best route runner in the NFL, incredibly savvy, and really an elite target share because of his versatility. He ran a lot of routes in the slot, but can run an equal amount of routes out on the outside. You have a lot of different opportunities for Keenan Allen in that offense. He was 10th in the NFL in yards after the catch as well. So very reliable option from the get-go with Justin Herbert last season. Jared mentioned a couple of games that are kind of outliers for him from last season that went towards his finish, that kind of make his finish look a little bit, make it look worse than what it really was on a per-game basis. So Keenan Allen, fantastic target for you this year. And the Chargers could be in for a big season offensively and in fantasy. And what scares me is that you think about maybe just from last season, some guys who had big fantasy seasons. I think Justin Jefferson aside, but like the Bills breaking through for a huge season, making the playoffs. Kamara, the number one running back.
Yeah.
The Saints made the playoffs. Stop talking about Keenan Allen. Stop talking about Austin Eckler being top guys, because if they aren't, you know,
the Chargers might not make the playoffs. I think they'll make the playoffs. They almost likely won't beat the Chiefs for the division, but I would be surprised if they aren't a wild card team. And Keenan Allen, I absolutely love him. I love him even more than Tmack does this year. And he's just got such a good floor in this offense. He gets so many targets. He's the guy for Justin Herbert, and he's going to continue to target him. I see him as a top five wide receiver.
Yeah, the offense will be much improved this season, I think, with the new coaching staff. Anthony Lynn was
for sure
a dumb.
Yeah, you didn't even mention that. The coaching staff is definitely going to help out with that.
Yeah, so let's go to who you have at number seven.
My number seven, another guy we talked about last video, it's Calvin Ridley of the Atlanta Falcons. Look, Julio's gone. He's going to have an even bigger target share in this offense. He's going to be an elite wide receiver. He's going to get the touchdowns. There's nothing not to like about this guy. And like, as I said in the last video, I tried to get in my top five, but I couldn't, mainly because of the other guys I love. But Calvin Ridley, there's no reason not to draft him. Like, he's going to be so efficient, so heavily targeted. so many touchdowns. I don't see any reason why he would finish outside this top 10 wide receiver list.
Yeah, no doubt. 178 target pace without Julio Jones in the 8 games he's played without him. So big season, I think, ahead for Calvin Ridley without Julio Jones in the offense.
Definitely.
Let's go to who I have at number 7, someone that we've had a lot of conversations about in the last couple of episodes, bounce back included, Michael Thomas of the New Orleans Saints. I am definitely higher than most on Michael Thomas,
a
couple spots, but not higher than Jared. again, last video, yes, Jared has Michael Thomas in his top 5. There's still someone who I haven't said yet. Wait for that, and you'll find out that he's also in Jared's top 5. MT, the offense is completely absent of any other receiving weapons right now. They didn't make any additions. Michael Thomas proved that he can be a great wide receiver and a successful fantasy wide receiver without Drew Brees. We saw it with Teddy Bridgewater as well. If he's on the field, he's going to have the highest target share in the NFL. Plain and simple. If he's healthy, No one will have the target share Michael Thomas has. So I think there's a lot of opportunity for Michael Thomas, if he's on the field this season, to bounce back and have potentially a top 5 year, but I think 7 is a really appropriate spot for me. But again, more info on Michael Thomas. A bit of a deep dive on all the numbers you can expect to see and what we've seen from in the past that tell us what we're going to see this season. So check out the previous video for that. Do you want to comment on Michael Thomas? I feel like you don't even need to. You love him so much. But
I mean, the guy catches so many footballs and he catches them at an insane rate. As I said in the last video, his contested catch rate, or just his true catch rate, was 94.9% in 2019 when he had, like, what was it, like 160 targets? Some insane number like that. Like that's insane. He's going to catch everything and he's going to get so many yards. I think he's going to be so involved in the red zone as long as Jameis Winston is the starter, which I believe will happen. So no reason not to love Michael Thomas this year. Finally, we're going to talk about somebody who we haven't talked about yet.
Yeah.
And that is DK Metcalf, my wide receiver 8 of the Seattle Seahawks. DK Metcalf, coming out of college, like, everyone was worried about his 3-cone, whatever it was,
his agility score.
But he is just
a freak
athlete. Yeah. Like, this guy runs so fast. He's huge. He's just able to make massive plays down the field. And with Russell Wilson at quarterback, this guy has so much upside every week. The only reason I don't have him higher is because we sort of saw a bit of a drop off when Russell Wilson was no longer getting let cook.
Yeah. I mean, it is incredible what changed for that team halfway through the season.
Yeah.
And now Pete Carroll wants to talk about how much more they want to establish the run the ball.
I don't know what's going on with this team.
So
they want to let Russ cook and then they want to run the ball. It's like, what are they doing?
Yeah. So here's where I'm at with DK Metcalf. Like you mentioned, there's huge, like, the deep ball upside and the winning weeks from DK Metcalf, I think you're going to get. That's definitely going to happen. Where I'm a little bit worried is, like we mentioned, the running of the ball. And he just doesn't have that elite target share. He doesn't have the Michael Thomas target share. He doesn't have the Keenan Allen target share.
I think he only had like 80 catches last year.
Yeah, he had, I think, 88 receptions. So that's where I'm a little bit worried about putting him in this group. But the reason I do have him in this group is, if you're a big play wide receiver who did end the season as I think he was 17th in targets. So actually, it might have been 15, but it was somewhere around there. I still have to keep you in my top 10 because you're getting these high upside plays and high upside opportunities, and you're getting them at a pretty good rate. So I think you got to keep DK in your top 10 as sketched out, I guess I would say, as I am about the way Pete Carroll's been talking about the offense. He's still got a massive upside in terms of the quality of those targets.
Yeah, I mean, no reason to not like the upside he has.
Yeah.
Just the floor is a little worrisome. He's going to have those bad weeks.
So DK Metcalf, I do have him in my top 10, like I mentioned, but there's one guy I do have in front of him. So at number 8, I have Justin Jefferson. Last season, Adam Thielen had what was one of the most perplexing finishes in fantasy football. He had, I believe it was 12 red zone touchdowns, I think is what it was.
Like 13 total touchdowns,
yeah,
or something.
And they were like all in the red zone. So Adam Thielen hogged the red zone from Justin Jefferson last season. Like, he was the guy in the red zone for Kirk Cousins. If Justin Jefferson can get a fraction of that share this season, which after what we saw, 1,400 yards last year, I don't know why he wouldn't be looked to more often there. 26% target share in his rookie season. I mean, if we're talking about some guys who had really successful rookie seasons, DK Metcalf, AJ Brown, they didn't have the target share that Justin Jefferson had last season. I wanted to pull one stat here to really kind of take this take over from why I have him in front of DK Metcalf. Again, DK Metcalf in my 9 slot in the top 10. Justin Jefferson, I looked at his splits against top 10 defenses, top 10 passing defenses last season. So 5 games in this split, so 5 games he played against top 10 defenses, he actually had a better finish in PPR, 18 PPR points per game and 16.7 PPR points per game out of the split. So he actually performed better, had more receptions, had way more targets. He had 10.4 targets compared to 6.6 targets in the games with teams that had a poor or that had a good passing offense, top 10 passing offense. So it's hard to call this a fluke when he was relied on in the toughest games of the year for them, and he performed. He performed really well. So I like Justin Jefferson. I'm not in love with him just because of the pass or the running volume of the team and the philosophy there. And if their defense improves, they might not be throwing the ball as often as they'd like. They drafted Darisaw in the first round, so maybe they're looking to run the ball same rate, if not more, and might be even more successful this year. So that's the only way I'm a little bit worried about Jefferson. But man, it's hard to say that this rookie year isn't sustainable.
He had one of the best rookie seasons we've ever seen.
Yeah, of all time.
Like, he's going to put up a lot of points this year. And as you mentioned, the only worry I have is like, they're going to run the ball so often. Adam Thielen is still going to be involved in this offense, although I think his role will be declining.
It's got to change.
But he's still going to have a role. And like, Irv Smith, he'll play a role too. Like, Dalvin Cook will play a role in the receiving offense. Like,
yeah, always will.
How good will this offense be? Especially if your boy Kellen Mond comes in there. Then we might see an incredible offense.
Then the offense is just going to go straight downhill.
But to me, there's a clear 11, like top 11 wide receivers. And I had to leave Justin Jefferson out, unfortunately. Like, I love him, but it's hard. I didn't know who to take out of this list. And Justin Jefferson ended up being the one guy that was left out for me.
I got you. Okay, who do you have at number 9 then?
My number 9, you might have expected this to be a guy in my first top 5, but it's Devontae Adams of the Green Bay Packers. Yeah, I know, all the way down at 9 after finishing wide receiver 1 last season. He had 18 or 19 touchdowns last year, and like, the only reason not to like him is because I don't know what's happening with Aaron Rodgers. Like, Aaron Rodgers, if he doesn't play, what are we going to get from Devontae Adams? Probably like a back end wide receiver 1, maybe top end wide receiver 2. He doesn't have the upside without Rodgers. And when I'm doing my rankings, I want to find the guys who I think have safer upsides. And Devontae Adams doesn't have that safer upside because we don't know what's happening with Rodgers. So that's pretty much my only reason for having him this low.
Guys, comments, hit him with the clown emojis. What a goofball. Guy, I don't want to get too far into this because that's, you know, move along to 10, but Devontae Adams, even without Aaron Rodgers in 2017, was top 5 in red zone targets. If we're putting Devontae Adams in your 9 slot, you're never going to draft him. And that's fine.
Without Rodgers, he was wide receiver 14 in, I think, was it 2017 or 2018?
Yes, competing with Jordy Nelson and Randall Cobb in the offense. Right now, there's no other group. I do think I'm more bullish and expect Aaron Rodgers to be back. Jared has said it before. He'll probably say it again. He probably would have said it again if I don't say it. We don't know. Yeah. You know, Aaron Rodgers is trying to keep things in the dark on this. I don't think he has a lot of leverage. I don't see how you can put Devontae Adams in the 9, considering that the efficiency, the target share he has in the red zone, the touchdown numbers that I think for him are, like, we usually talk about touchdowns like they're not a sticky stat and can be so can fluctuate so much year in and year out. But with Devontae Adams, the way that he's targeted, especially red zone wise, I don't see that changing.
I just think his top 11 are so close that I'd rather take like a Calvin Ridley or DeAndre Hopkins, guys that will for sure give you that role no matter the quarterback.
Yeah,
and but I think Devontae Adams will do that.
Yeah, I think Devontae can still be a wide receiver 1 with Jordan Love.
Maybe.
And right now you're drafting him as
maybe
like,
wide receiver 1, but back end wide receiver 1.
But you're already putting him here in these rankings like he's not going to be there. Anyways, let's get to 10. You hit me with your 10 and then we'll
by the way, your 9 was DK Metcalf. We already talked about him.
Yeah, I said that there earlier, so he should be in there for you.
My number 10, it's AJ Brown of the Tennessee Titans. Now, Julio Jones is coming to the offense. I don't think it really impacts AJ Brown all that much. Like, maybe he's going to get fewer targets, but like, he's still going to be so efficient with the receptions he gets. Like, this guy can do it with 80 receptions.
So his touchdown rate last year was pretty much the same as Davante Adams. That's where I'm just a little bit worried. He was like 15%. But there is like the departure of like Jonnu Smith is
freak
huge.
Wide receiver, though. I think he's better than Davante Adams as a wide receiver. That might be a hot take.
But the offense is going to still run, like, they're going to run the ball a lot. That's where I'm worried about A.J. Brown just because of the target share.
He doesn't need it, though.
Might improve, but I don't know how many more touchdowns. I don't think he scores more touchdowns. What did he finish as, the 14?
I think something along there, but he was also injured for the first four games or so of the year.
I like A.J. Brown. I'm just, and there's targets that are left over from Jonnu Smith departing, which was a good amount, and I don't think Firkser is going to take all those over. But
A.J. Brown.
Julio Jones is going to need more volume than what, you know, Corey Davis did last year. So I just don't know how I can project him for too much more than what I saw from him last season. And then the touchdown rate does worry me a bit. Does he score just as much with the amount of receptions? That's why he's not in my top 10. But I mean, A.J. Brown is still a great option. Like, Tannehill's had a fantastic number of seasons now in Tennessee. So
for sure, like Julio and Derrick Henry, they're both going to get their work, plenty of work. But A.J. Brown, he's just so good with the ball in his hands. He's going to make such good plays. He could literally catch three balls for like 90 yards and a touchdown.
There were at least a few times last year. I remember keeping up with him, watching Red Zone, or I have a couple other games on, and I'm looking at my fantasy team. I'm like, A.J. Brown, when are you going to show up? And then all of a sudden I reload, and it's just like, oh, okay, we got 15 points. We're good.
This offense is going to be really good too. Like, I think everyone underrates Ryan Tannehill. I think he's a top 10 quarterback in the NFL. And with Julio and A.J. Brown on the outside, they can't double team A.J. Brown anymore. Like, he's going to be so efficient. This offense is going to score so many points.
They're not going to play defense, so they might be on the field a lot, right?
That's good.
So
means he's going to score more points.
Exactly. So, I I'm not off on A.J. Brown, but I do just a little bit of the worry with the touchdown rate and then the impact of Julio Jones. So who I have instead of him at 10, yes, we have already talked about this guy.
In
the last video. Terry McLaurin. I have him at my number 10 slot of the Washington football team. You have not heard Jared talk about him yet. Why? Because he's in Jared's top five. And there's more info on Terry McLaurin here in that video. So definitely, like I said, check it out. I'll give you a couple things that we did mention. This is what surprised me from last year when I'm looking at the numbers, the tape, and taking it from what he finished last year, which we did mention was a little bit of the injury issues that impacted his finish. But this team, with Alex Smith, who's known to not be able to feed fantasy-relevant wide receivers very well. There was a stretch where he didn't throw a touchdown to a wide receiver for like 2 years.
Back with Kansas City.
The offense on passing plays threw to wide receivers 51% of the time. That's incredible that 49% of their targets went to either the tight end or the running back. We know Ryan Fitzpatrick. Not about that life.
Yeah.
Absolutely not about that life. So that's going to change.
He's a gunslinger.
McLaurin, with that 51%, had 8.9 targets per game, had 9 targets a game. So that's going to improve. I think Curtis Samuel, with his addition, isn't going to take away from McLaurin. It's going to take away from what Logan Thomas and J.D. McKissick did last season. That's the role that Curtis Samuel thrives in. So that's why I have Terry McLaurin in my top 10, and I think he definitely takes a jump this year compared to last season. Not enough for me to put him into my top five, but I like
He's so Terry. Underrated as a receiver. I'm going to keep saying it because he is. He's an elite wide receiver. We just haven't seen him put up those elite numbers yet because of the scenarios he's been put in. Look, he had 4 starting quarterbacks last season. 4.
No he could other, have 2 this year, though.
No
he could
other
have
guys
2.
Have that many. And he played on 2 high ankle sprains. Like, and he still put up, he was probably a wide receiver 2 last year. I think he had like 1,100 yards and 4 touchdowns. But
oh, yeah. Yes, yeah, yeah. I thought you were going to say per game. I wonder what per game with the... Or you said the first 9
The first
weeks.
9 weeks, he had 17 points per game, which would have been probably around like wide receiver 8 or 7, something like that.
Yeah.
So I love Terry McLaurin. If you want more info on him, last video. But
yeah,
no
absolutely.
Reason why he shouldn't be a top 10 guy for everyone, at least.
There's a good path, great path to a great season for Terry. I'm just, again... He'll probably see 2, you know, Fitzmagic gets crazy. We'll see 4 interceptions in a game, and it might be Taylor Heineke time. So that's where there could be some craziness from Terry McLaurin week in and week out. But anyways, those are our top 10 wide receivers. If you enjoyed the video, smash the like button. drop a comment down below.
Who'd
remember
we miss?
The clown emojis for Jared and his McLaurin takes and his, who else was it?
Davante Adams.
Davante Adams take at number 9.
Comment who we missed though. Who's in your top 10 that we didn't talk about?
Yeah, absolutely. And again, join the Discord. Details are down below on that as well. Happy to give any fantasy football advice. Talk some fantasy football. But thank you guys so much for tuning in. We'll see you next time.